LiBiondo, colleagues and friends, ladies and gentlemen. I wish to extend my sincere thanks to CMA organizers for granting me the privilege and honor of chairing the opening session of this year's CMA, and nothing less on the state of the industry as it is today. Before I start, I just wanted to say that I'm sure you all have seen terrible pictures from Japan where the earthquake followed by a tsunami and then the unfortunate incidents with the nuclear power plants have really touched all of us. And I just want to say that our thoughts are with the Japanese people, and we are very thankful for the Japanese colleagues who came here to join us here, and please rest assured that our thoughts are with you.
Good afternoon, and thank you very much. It is a distinct honor for me to have the opportunity to join you for this session this afternoon, and maybe just as importantly for the last 24 hours or so in a learning experience, which I think is going to serve me extremely well as chair of the committee. It's an opportunity for me to hear from a lot of different experts, real world experts. You know, Washington is loaded with experts. The problem is they don't live or think in the real world. So they come up with ideas and solutions that are very difficult to implement because they're unworkable. So this is an opportunity for me to be able to hear directly from you on issues that are important and issues that can make a difference. We have many challenges that we're facing. Chief among these challenges is the further development of our ports and waterways. It's a critical issue because, as many of you know, our vessel ports are in need of some serious infrastructure improvements. Inadequate maintenance over the years has caused a number of problems, and the situation from an economic standpoint, a budget standpoint, with the United States government is not going to get any better. But it's an opportunity that we're going to have to figure out how we deal with if we're going to keep maritime trade up and running. Roughly 25% of our gross domestic product comes through our ports. It's a huge economic driver for the United States government, and it's over $1 billion in export, creates an additional 15,000 jobs. So if we look at it in this sense, with a high unemployment rate, it's one of those areas where spending money will make us money. And I hope that's what my colleagues will understand as we debate these budget issues and try to move forward. It's time that we start spending down the massive $5 billion balance in the Harbor Maintenance Trust Fund. These dollars have been put away, they're for a specific purpose, and it is hard for me to comprehend that my colleagues don't understand that with tight economic times, and a very dramatic need for harbor maintenance, and a $5 billion pot of money sitting there, they don't have to argue over where they're going to get the money from. It's not a matter of raising new taxes. It's not a matter of taking it from somewhere else. It's a matter of using what we already have. So sometimes the simplest and most common sense solutions are the hardest to accomplish, and it seems that on this harbor maintenance issue, that may be one of them. Another big issue that we're, oh, by the way, there is legislation that will free this up, that will get this moving. I'm co-sponsor of the legislation, and there have been a lot of promises over the years about what would and would not be done. I am cautiously optimistic we'll be able to develop enough momentum to actually see some real progress in this particular area. Another area that's key and crucial to everyone attending this conference is that with regulations. We've come into a situation where the common sense approach seems to have been thrown out the window. We have courts that are making decisions that are dictating these decisions down that the EPA, Environmental Protection Agency, is interpreting to allow certain things to go on. And what it is creating is an atmosphere that you can't operate in. There needs to be a single standard. No excuses, no changes. Individual states cannot be allowed to move forward on their own with what they're choosing to do, with their view of how things have to take place. Right in the Northeast, we have a situation with the state of New York, who is putting in regulations that are 1,000 times more stringent than what the IMO is calling for. We've talked with the Port Authority, talked with the Port of New York. We believe we have their attention, but this cannot be allowed to progress. You have to be able to operate with business certainty. Uncertainties are one of the biggest dampeners that we have for business in this country. Whether it's with tax structure, whether it's with regulation, across the board, you can operate if you have the certainty to know what it is you're expected to do. So it's going to be my charge as part of the subcommittee's agenda to make sure that we hold this as a high priority, and hopefully we can accomplish and get, it's like herding cats with bringing all these people together. They all have a different direction they want to go. They all have a different idea of why they want to go that way. But I can assure you that this will be a huge priority for this, for us. Another issue that's been receiving a lot of attention, our last speaker was very dynamic with luncheon, and through some of the meetings this morning, we've had discussions about this, and even yesterday and last night, the issue of piracy. There's a lot of hand-wringing and what do we do, and where do we go, and how do we do this? And I don't want to oversimplify the situation, but we have a crisis on our hands. And so far, we don't have the will to deal with it. And I'm not saying it's as simple as certain people making a decision that we're finally going to deal with it, but it comes close to that. We have technology, we have abilities that we are not utilizing. Now, yes, the United States cannot act unilaterally. We need our partners with foreign nations, we need our partners that are in different phases of the industry to help bring this all together. But as I've mentioned at other times, these are not disadvantaged youth that we're dealing with that have had a troubled childhood, and we need to be careful of how we handle them. These are very bad people who are torturing and killing. These are very bad people who are disrupting world commerce. It's costing tens of billions of dollars, and nobody knows that better than you do. And my question to my colleagues, and to those who have an ability to make the decisions here, what will it take? What will it take to wake us up? What will it take to move us off the dime? Will it take a cruise ship? Will it take a supersized tanker? Will it take a whole crew being wiped out? What will it take before we say enough is enough? It's not enough that we have 800 or 1,000 hostages. It's not enough that we had four Americans that were killed. It's not enough that we've had all the torturing and whatever else is going on that we're not even aware of. So we're going to have to get serious about it. I think the reality is that the United States Navy and the United States Coast Guard will not be placing personnel on ships. And we don't have enough ships to patrol the whole area. So what can we do that can make a difference? I think there are options. I mean, obviously, as ship owners, you're doing a lot of best practice ideas. You're doing a lot of taking the situation into control of your own with armed crews that are on armed security teams that are on board. That I understand, unless my information is wrong, that there has not been a ship with an armed security team that has actually had a hostage taken. But what do the pirates do from here? So they're gaining a lot of money from the ransoms. Now the mother ships are captured ships that are much larger and have a much greater range. And what weaponry do they now start to buy and show up with that we haven't seen before? So that the citadel of the ship is not secure anymore? I mean, what do? Do they bring people on with blow torches and start cutting open the doors? I mean, we don't know. But through the hearing that the Coast Guard and Maritime Subcommittee had last week, we attempted to focus attention on this, and we're going to continue to try to find ways where we can bring this to a level where actual real decisions are made with a real clear directive that gives us a very clear outcome. And this ambiguity that we see across the board, I think, is costing us all dearly. It's cost us in lives. It's cost us in property, and I don't think it's going to get better on its own. So we have an awful lot of work to do together. As we run through these many challenges and issues that are facing with the maritime industry, And whether it's simple issues that are in our ports, that if we had the money, we can provide the infrastructure, or more complicated issues like the piracy issue. I think that it requires a partnership to find these solutions. No one can act unilaterally and make this happen, and make it happen in a good way. My time in Congress has all about been developing partnerships, finding ideas that work across a broad spectrum, bringing people together who have the expertise from the real world. And that's where CMA plays a crucial and key role. We need your expertise, we need your involvement, we need your participation, and together I think we can make a real difference. Thank you for having me here today.